Hey guys, welcome to our movie recap. Today we're gonna recap the film from the year 2023, titled The Park. Before we start, remember to like and subscribe for more movie recaps. When the film begins, we see global chaos as a lethal virus annihilates the adult population worldwide. This leaves children as the sole survivors, but their safety is short-lived, for they too are destined to die of the virus upon reaching puberty. In this apocalyptic world, with adults gone and no one to maintain order to provide necessities, resources diminish rapidly. This dire scarcity forces the children into a brutal, savage existence, where they turn on each other in violent clashes over the most basic of needs. The story then shifts to a young boy navigating the dangerous swamps. His solitude is interrupted when he encounters Ainz and Bew. Ainz, in a tense confrontation, demands the boy's backpack, but he fiercely refuses, using a screwdriver in defense. The situation escalates when Ainz retaliates with her machete, leading to a tragic outcome where the boy is fatally wounded. The grim reality of their world is further underscored when Bew's search for vital resources like water in the boy's backpack yields only toys, a deep reminder of the lost innocence in this harsh new world. Intriguingly, a distant melody catches Ainz's attention, leading her and Bew to investigate. They glimpse another girl, Quan, armed and seemingly in possession of water, near an amusement park. This setting puzzles Bew, as it doesn't appear on their map. Despite the risks, including the looming threat of the Blue Meanie, a ruthless children's gang that rules the area, Ainz decides to approach Quan alone, faking an injury to gain her trust. Ainz's encounter with Quan unfolds with cautious diplomacy. Quan, upon Ainz's request, shares her water, a gesture of rare humanity in their cruel world. The conversation between them reveals Ainz's intention to travel to Derby, fueled by rumors of a child prodigy who has reportedly developed a vaccine. Quan is visibly excited at the prospect of meeting new people. She even goes as far as to disarm herself. The narrative takes an intriguing turn as Quan reveals to Ainz a significant project she claims will alter the future. Seizing an opportune moment, Ainz attempts to take control by grabbing Quan's gun, only to discover it's a harmless toy. This revelation infuriates Ainz, and in her agitated state, she accidentally steps on a nail, injuring herself. This moment of vulnerability leads to a nightmare, from which she awakens to find Quan compassionately tending to her wounded foot. Quan's unexpected kindness continues as she offers Ainz dinner, prompting Ainz to question her motives. Responding to Ainz's curiosity, Quan leads her to the amusement park's power control center, revealing her ambitious endeavor, working on a cure. Ainz's excitement is palpable as she realizes Quan might be the child prodigy rumored to be developing a vaccine. However, Quan unveils a twist. Her cure isn't for the virus, but aims to address the altered perspective of adulthood. Amidst their heated argument, Bew unexpectedly arrives, attacking Quan with a lacrosse stick. The ensuing struggle sees Quan overpower Bew and flee into the night, her familiarity with the park's layout giving her a distinct advantage in the darkness. Quan's strategic prowess becomes evident as she methodically incapacitates Bew and Ainz one by one. As dawn breaks, a new scene unfolds. Ainz awakens to the sight of Bew energetically riding a bicycle, ingeniously rigged to pump water into a water slide. It's here that Quan presents her vision for the park, a sanctuary where the remaining children can unite and thrive. Quan invites Ainz to join her on the water slide, leading to an unexpected bonding experience as they laugh and revel in the joy of the ride, a stark contrast to the grim reality surrounding them. However, their brief break is overshadowed by the impending threat of the Blue Meanies, a notorious children's gang, converging on the park. Bew, his legs bound in chains, observes Ainz and Quan enjoying themselves on the waterslide. His annoyance is palpable, feeling excluded and restrained. Meanwhile, Quan, optimistic and hopeful, envisions reopening the amusement park and tentatively asks Ainz if they can consider themselves allies now. In a surprising revelation, Quan shows Ainz a locker where she hid the keys to Biyu's chains, along with an arsenal of real firearms. A moment of danger arises when a snake nearly bites Quan, but Ainz swiftly intervenes, using Quan's knife to kill the snake and save her. This act of bravery strengthens their bond. As they engage in the task of painting the old playground, Quan opens up about her personal life, sharing the story of her brother Luca, who had gone to fetch water from the river and hadn't returned. Ainz is struck by the realization that Luca is the boy she had previously killed, but she keeps this dark secret to herself. After they finish painting, Ainz secretly takes the keys to Biyu's chains, but her attempt to unlock them fails, leading Biyu to express his distrust of Quan, labeling her as unstable and different from them. This conversation triggers a flashback for Ainz, revealing her ruthless rise to power within her former group. She had forcefully taken control from the group's leader, prioritizing their survival over others. The flashback also shows Ainz coldly handing her machete to Biyu, signaling him to execute the former leader. As the flashback ends, the scene shifts back to the present, where Ainz prepares a meal from the snake she had killed. The conversation then takes a more introspective turn, as Ainz shares her own backstory. She recounts spending much of her childhood in a hospital, isolated and without anyone to talk to. She had never met her parents and found comfort in reading, especially stories filled with disasters and monsters. These tales fueled her imagination, leading her to ponder how she would react in similar catastrophic events. She even started researching survival techniques, which amused some visitors who overheard her. Despite the oddity of her interest, Ainz confesses that she began to believe in the reality of these disaster scenarios, almost as if she was anticipating the end of the world. In a climactic moment, Ainz successfully restores the electricity to the park, and with a flick of a switch, the amusement park bursts into life. Soon after, Quan's concern for her missing brother Luca grows intensely as he still hasn't returned. In a desperate attempt to signal him, Quan launches fireworks into the sky. However, this act inadvertently alerts the Blue Meanies to their location, now threateningly close. Amidst this escalating tension, Ainz steps in to soothe Quan, and the two find comfort in each other's company, comforting one another in their shared anxiety. But this brief moment of peace is shattered when Biyu, having managed to break free from his chains, approaches them with a sense of urgency. He confronts Ainz with a difficult choice, to leave with him or stay. As Biyu attempts to convey his warning to Quan, he inadvertently cuts Ainz's wrist with Luca's screwdriver. Quan, reacting quickly, takes the screwdriver to assist Ainz, but her emotions are a mix of heartbreak and anger. She adamantly tells them to leave the park forever. However, their departure is halted as Quan suddenly starts coughing and collapses, a sign that she's reached puberty and the deadly virus has taken hold of her. This dramatic turn of events is compounded by the arrival of the Blue Meanies. Ainz and Biyu, now in survival mode, hastily hide themselves. A violent encounter ensues between Biyu and one of the Blue Meanies, during which Ainz prepares to use a gun to defend Biyu. Her attempt is crushed by another member of the gang, forcing Ainz and Biyu to make a swift escape into the woods, with the Blue Meanies in close pursuit. As they continue their harrowing journey, a rainstorm provides them a momentary break. Ainz reveals her deep regret at not being able to bid farewell to Quan. Clutching Quan's diary, which she has kept close all this while, Ainz contemplates the recent events. Biyu, observing this, becomes enraged, as this side of Ainz is foreign to him. In a fit of anger, he throws the diary in the ocean. Ainz, driven by emotion, rushes into the water to retrieve it. Biyu, despite not knowing how to swim, follows her. In a critical moment, Ainz confesses to Biyu that she would have chosen Quan's company over his just a day ago. This revelation is quickly overshadowed by a life-threatening situation as Biyu begins to drown. Ainz acts swiftly, pulling him from the water and performing CPR, ultimately saving his life. In the intense climax of the movie, Ainz, weary from the relentless pursuit and survival, decides to take a bold stand against the Blue Meanies. She devises a plan where Bu will act as a bait to draw them out. Bu, placing his trust in Ainz, agrees to this risky strategy. As dawn breaks, the Blue Meanies in their relentless search are lured in by Bu's singing, setting the stage for a confrontation. In the ensuing chaos, Ainz manages to disarm the Blue Meanies, gaining control of their gun. However, in a surprising turn of events, she chooses not to harm them. Instead, she observes that the Blue Meanies, nearing puberty, exhibit noticeably swollen voices, a symptom of the virus. It's at this moment that Ainz discovers the true intentions of the Blue Meanies. They weren't enemies, but fellow survivors attempting to help. This revelation dramatically shifts the dynamics of their encounter. Tragically, Ainz soon finds herself submitting to the same fate as Quan, as she starts coughing and collapses. In a surreal afterlife experience, she encounters Quan, who seems to have been in the ethereal state for an eternity, indicating her death. Quan imparts a deep message to Ainz about the significance of helping others in life. Ainz awakens in the Blue Meanie's camp, where she makes a startling discovery. Her larynx, voice box, has been surgically removed, a drastic measure by the Blue Meanies as a cure for the virus. Around her, she sees others who have undergone the same procedure, a haunting but necessary sacrifice for survival. Reunited with Bu, she resolves to assist in finding other children before they reach puberty and provide them with this grim but life-saving treatment. Days later, the film presents a scene of deceptive calm, with Bu and Ainz relaxing under a tree. Their moment of peace is abruptly interrupted when a girl armed with a pistol attempts to rob them. However, Ainz and Bu have prepared for such threats, and the girl is quickly trapped in a booby trap, now hanging by her legs. Ainz approaches her with a writing pad, a gesture of communication and offering help, asking if she's hungry. The movie concludes on a note of cautious optimism. The children, despite their daunting challenges and sacrifices, gather around a fire, united in their resolve to survive and build a future. The scene is heartwarmingly filled with Bu playing a guitar, a substitute for the voices they've lost, symbolizing hope and resilience in the face of adversity. The story, through its narrative, deeply highlights themes of survival, the power of human connection, and the relentless spirit of children in a world forever changed by a catastrophic event. Was that cure anything like what you expected it to be? Let me know in the comments below. And if you enjoyed this video, remember to give us a like and subscribe to the channel. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next movie recap.